Hello everybody, I hope you guys are doing good today. Alright, well before we get started, I want to tell you how this video is going to work. You saw by the title, I am going to tell you how I grew up in the ghetto. Now, like I said, before we get into that, just a couple of things. The first thing, I think that I'm going to make this the first episode of a series of episodes telling you about my life. I don't know what I'll call the playlist, maybe just like my life story or I don't know, something like that. A while ago, I actually made a video. I titled it Something I Need to Say. That was, I guess you could say, like a prelude to what this series would be. I'll leave a link to it in the description. But yeah, so let's get started. All right. Well, the first thing that I want to say is there are, for those of you who don't know or those of you who never, like, you know, don't know anything about that area, I guess you could say the ghetto has different levels. I don't know how many levels there are, but for now, I'll just say there's two. There is bad, and then there is very bad, all right? I lived in the bad, all right? I didn't live it when it was, like, really, really bad. But, okay, well, to begin, I believe that I lived in the ghetto for about 10 years, because I think I moved out of it, I think, when I was 10. So yeah, I'm gonna say I was in there for a while, I was like, you know, my first 10 years of living. But I grew up in Seat Pleasant, Maryland. And that is more so of a low income neighborhood. But let me just try my best to describe the environment. Okay, when I said the bad, like the very bad ghetto, that's not what I lived in. That normally has like the actual, like the killings, the gangs, like the actual like drugs, like that's like the serious stuff. I lived in, like I said, the not so bad ghetto, but it was still bad. Like we still had crime, we still had violence, we still, it was still like dangerous. I will get into that in just a minute. But yeah, so I guess to describe, I guess, some of the things that, like I'm basically just gonna tell you things that I remember, because like I said, like, I'm like really, really young, so I'm telling you stuff that I just kind of remember from my memory, and then I guess evaluating it now, me being 21. So, I remember that, and these will help you get the idea of, I guess you could say, how things were for me. But I remember there was this one time, me and my sister were walking home from school. Not even walking home from school. It's like, we got off the bus and it dropped us off near our house. So we were just walking back to our house and it was so bizarre. Like, you know how, if you're in an environment, some things just flow with the environment. Like say you're in nature, a bird flying through the sky. That's a part of the environment. You know, butterflies. That's a part of the environment. Me and my sister are just walking up to our house, more like our apartment. We lived in an apartment, and we see a guy getting chased by the police, and their guns are drawn. But it was weird. It was like everything was quiet. First off, like it was like there wasn't like any sound outside, like maybe like some cars or whatnot. But it's just an ordinary time. Me and my sister walking home, and then we just look to the side, and we just see this guy run, just followed by two police officers with their guns drawn. And then me and my sister just looked at each other, like we couldn't quite grasp what just happened. Like I said, like my sister is like 3 years older than me. So if I was like, I don't know how old I was, but if I'm like 7, then she was like 10. Like we're like little kids, so we don't quite understand what we just saw. So like that was just one thing. And like I said, expect this to kind of be kind of random, because like I said, I'm like remembering things in like in just like a different order. I can tell you how it was for me growing up in my place. So like I said, I lived in an apartment. I think it was like a two-bedroom apartment. It was two bedrooms. We had like a little kitchenette and then like a living room area. And it was my parents, so it was my mom and my dad. It was me, my sister, my grandmother, and my aunt. But my aunt is very close to my sister's age. Like, I think my aunt may be like 6 years older than me, and so that makes her like 3 years older than my sister, I think. If you're watching this, hi. I don't know if I should say your name. I don't know if you'll be cool with that, but hi. If you're watching this. But yeah, so it was essentially the six of us. However, my grandmother babysat very often, so like just the other kids in the area. So our house was mostly filled with a ton of kids, a lot of the time. So it was like, you know, it's kind of crowded. Essentially, the way the living situation worked, my grandmother and my aunt was in one of the bedrooms. They kind of lived there. My sister, my mom, my dad, and me, we stayed in the other bedroom. Our bedroom had a closet. That closet was my sister's room. They converted it into a room. I shared a room with my parents. Like, there was their bed, and then I had a bed next to them. And then, you know, we had the rest of the house. So it was kind of crowded most times. So yeah, I guess that just gives you an idea as to how, you know, we lived. And I guess for other things, like I said, our neighborhood, it wasn't dangerous, but it did have danger. There were still things that you did and didn't do, and like just other like little forms of protocol. Like, I guess for me, being as young as I was, some of the little rules that my parents set for me, we actually had two playgrounds. One was, I guess you could say, more and towards the left area, and the other one was more towards like the right area. We were not allowed to go to one of, basically, we were only allowed to go to the playground that was visible from our window. Like, in our room, we had a window, and from that window, we could see the playground. We were only allowed to go to that playground because they can keep an eye on us. The other playground, we weren't allowed to go to until we were older because they, you know, can't see us. They don't know, you know, what's gonna happen. For the longest time, I had no idea. When I was younger, I was like, why can't we go to the playground? Like, we played with, like, some of the other kids in the neighborhood, and, you know, they didn't have anywhere near as many rules as me and my sister did. So it's like, you know, they did a whole bunch of stuff. They would go out the stores, they would, like, go to other, you know, the other playground. But me and my sister, you know, we couldn't do any of that stuff, and we had no idea. But that was, like, now that I'm older, that was why. It's because, you know, this still isn't, you know, the safest neighborhood. You don't know what could, you know, happen. To tell you just some of the other stories that I remember, my father, he got robbed a couple times. Not actually like, you know, like give me your money robbed, but like his car. Like several times our car got, I can't quite say robbed, but just like stolen from, I guess. Like, to give examples, like, one, I remember this one time where the rims on our wheels got stolen. We've had the rims of our car stolen. We had, like, several cars during this time, but we had the rims of our car stolen. We had the tags on our car stolen, like the license plate. We had the radio stolen. There was apparently a time where somebody actually tried to steal the whole car, and like I said, I don't quite remember all this stuff. This is like just the stuff that I was like, I said like that's like that my mom told me now that I'm older, and just you know, just other stuff. But yeah, like there was a time where they tried to steal the actual car, and my dad saw that and he ran outside, and they hopped into another car and drove off. So that apparently was unfortunately kind of like a regular thing. Another odd memory that I remember as a kid. I remember it was nighttime, and I think we had some groceries in the car. So we got the groceries, and we're, you know, like the way, you guys probably already know this, the way with groceries, you know, at least for us, you know, we normally had a lot, so we would have to do several trips. So we would take bags, go into the house, come back out, and you know, we were just going back and forth. And I remember when I was going back and forth, and the weird part is that I think I remember my dad being there. I just don't think he saw it, but I don't know. Essentially, near our apartment, or just in the driveway, there was a dumpster. There was a dumpster that had like a brick wall around the dumpster. So you can kind of picture that. Next to the dumpster, like next to the brick wall, were these guys playing dice. like, I don't know, I think they were gambling, like, I don't think my dad saw it, because, you know, he's trying to bring the groceries in, and I'm, like, you know, behind him bringing in the groceries. I didn't say anything, I didn't do anything, of course, I remember I just saw that, but, you know, it's, like, nighttime, they're, like, you know, shooting the dice, I think they're betting money, but, yeah, there was that. What else? Like, I'm just trying to remember just, like, things now. I don't know. Oh, how could I forget? Oftentimes, this is just, in the funny part is that a lot of this stuff, since I was so young, I didn't notice and I didn't flinch when it happened. To me, it was just normal. Like I said, it was just the environment that I grew up in. Hearing gunshots was a regular thing, especially during, like, New Year's or 4th of July. Mostly New Year's, like, you know, when you watch TV and, you know, they're counting down, like, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, Happy New Year! Boom, 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 and we would just hear, like, these things, like, these shots going off. It was a regular thing. I am not kidding. I remember this. It was a regular thing when we would, during New Year's, and, you know, they're doing the ball, the ball drop counting thing, and my parents would say, get down on the ground. Like, and we would do it, but it was so normal to me. Like we would get down and we were like, I'm sorry, I'm laughing remembering this. But like, we would get down on the ground and we'd be like, Happy New Year, because my parents were afraid that, you know, stray bullets or whatever, you know, but that never happened. Like, we always heard it in the distance, but still, like I said, that possibility was there that a stray bullet could come in through the window, so we would get down and be like, Happy New Year. Oh my gosh, like, I'm laughing at this now, because now I'm just thinking, like, wow, that really happened. As far as school went, like don't get me wrong, I actually have a ton of things to tell you about my school life. So like I said, that's my elementary, middle, and high school life. That is going to be in its own video, maybe even a couple of videos. But for now, I'll just kind of keep it simple. The schools that I went to when I was in Cedar Pleasant, honestly, at least for me and my experience, the ghetto-ness of the area, I don't think got into the schools. At least, you know, for me. Like, I can't really remember anything super serious or crazy happening to me while I was in school related to the area that we lived in. I do remember one thing, though. Luckily, none of this, you know, none of it came into something. But, and if it was really a problem, there's no way that they would allow, you know, kids to just be waiting out at a bus stop. But yeah, like, my neighborhood, you know, it had a lot of kids. And the way it worked, when we would go to school, like, you guys may or may not remember this with your school life, but I know there are times where there are particular bus stops that have a ton of children, because they all live in the area and they're all at that bus stop, so they all board that bus and they all go to the same school. There are other kids where there's like, it's just them or maybe like a couple more, but when I was in Cedar Pleasant, I was at one of the bus stops that had the massive congregation of children. And I remember there was this one event, there was this thing that was going around called like the sniper. I think it was this person. I don't even, like I said, me being a kid, I'm not even sure how much of this was true and how much of it was really dangerous. If it really was dangerous, I know they wouldn't allow like a bunch of kids just being out and about, you know, like, you know, waiting for a bus stop. I'm waiting for a bus. But I believe there was this thing going around. There was a guy who was supposed to be running around in a white van shooting people or something like that. Like I said, the story amongst us kids probably got really skewed. And I remember that, you know, I'm sorry, like, as I am remembering these things, I am laughing because there are these little details that I forgot. I remember my sister was a safety patrol. And, you know, she was in charge of, I guess, making sure the kids followed the rules and whatnot. It was a horrible job. Like, you know, no kid likes another kid telling them what to do. But, you know, me being her little brother and her making sure, you know, I guess all the other younger kids my age were safe or whatnot. We had, like, this hill that was next to the bus. And my sister would tell us to go down that hill. I don't know, it was like child logic. My sister was telling us to hide down that hill just in case if the sniper came by, he wouldn't see us, or to go, like, we had other dumpsters in the area that had that brick wall, to run behind that brick wall if something happened. I mean, to us, it was a game, like the other little kids, like me and the other little kids, to us, it was like a game, but, there was that. I'm trying to remember if there was, like, I'm quite sure there is a lot of other things that I can't remember, but like I said, I'm just kind of, like, pulling this out of my memory. Give me 1 second. Like, there was the stuff that happened in school. I don't quite remember. I guess this wasn't too serious, and I think it has to just do to be being how young I was. But I remember a lot of the kids. I remember a lot of the kids were troublemakers. I was about to say a lot of the boys were troublemakers, and of course they wanted me to do a lot of the things that they did. Now, like I said, due to us being so young, and none of it was ever truly serious, like we weren't like smoking or like doing drugs or like having guns or anything. It was just more like mischief. And, you know, of course I didn't want to do any of that stuff. I never did. And of course that didn't, you know, the boys didn't like me. But I don't really remember much from that time. Like I said, I was so young. As I got older, like I said, and I got, you know, into other schools, like I said, like middle school, and like I said, just other actual schools that I went into, you know, of course I was lonely, of course I didn't have that many friends for those reasons, because I didn't want to do all the crazy stuff that they were doing, but I'm trying to think if there was, like, any other specific things, or, just stuff like that. I think that is it in a nutshell. Like, I guess if I remember anything else, I can probably say it in other videos. But yeah, like, I just wanted to say, you know, like I said, I did grow up in the ghetto. It wasn't the super dangerous ghetto. Like, I really want to say that, because there are two very, very different levels. Like I said, maybe more levels, and I just don't know. But yeah, I did have to be, like I said, safety was, of course, the utmost priority. Like I said, there were certain rules, like, you know, I wasn't allowed to walk behind my parents. I always had to be within arm's reach of them, just in case, you know, just crazy stuff happening, so, you know, they could grab me and pull me toward them if they needed to. Like, I wasn't allowed to run too far ahead, I wasn't allowed to be behind them, which is funny, because I think that one time, like I said, with the guys playing dice, I just so happened to have been behind my father at the time, but, like, I don't know, that wasn't, like, too bad. But, like I said, we weren't allowed to go to the other playground where they couldn't see us. We couldn't go to the other side of the apartment where they couldn't see us. Like I said, we were on one side and there was the other side. We weren't allowed to go to that other side. My sister always had to be with me. Like, I wasn't allowed to, like, do anything by myself, which is something that I hated as a kid. Like, I really got my sister upset many times because I did not want to be with someone all the time. But, even though we did live in that environment, we still did, like, honestly, I still had a lot of fun, because my parents did a really good job. Like, I do have to say this, growing up, I at least for the first 10 years of my life, growing up, I was very sheltered. But it, as I just told you, it was for a reason. It's because, like, you saw it. The kids who their parents did not pay that much attention to, or I guess the kids who, I guess, given too much freedom in the environment we were in, did not have favorable results. Like, I have no idea what those kids are like now, today. They could be totally fine. They may not be. I do not know. But, that was the reason why my parents, like, sheltered me as much as they did. So it's like, when I was that young, I didn't quite comprehend the level of the environment I was in. It was more like I was in my own little bubble. It was a bubble that had Hot Wheels cars. I love the little Hot Wheels cars. It had Yu-Gi-Oh cards. It had Pokemon games. Had Dragon Ball Z when it would air on, like, Toonami. And just, I don't know, it was like kids stuff. So I'm actually really happy that my parents are able to, like, maintain that world for me, despite the environment that we lived in. Because, now that I think about it, there were times where we would not have dinner. Like, to be specific, more like dinner food, we would have to buy like really cheap stuff that would last a while. So there were several nights in a row where we would eat hot dogs. There was some nights where we didn't have any dinner food, so we had to eat ice cream, like, for dinner. And we just got really, really creative when it came to food. Like, if we didn't have, like, I don't know, let me think of something. If we didn't have peanut butter and jelly, we would make a peanut butter and banana sandwich. We actually learned that from, like, a little kids network. You guys remember Nick Jr.? That's still maybe on television. I just remember it was much different than how it is now. Like, I don't really know how it is now. But yeah, I think when we were watching, like, Nick Jr., they taught us how to make, like, a peanut butter and banana sandwich. And that was, like, the perfect thing to make when we didn't have actual food in the house. It's, like, other ingredients. So we would just get creative as to what we could make. Let me think. There were some stores that we frequented very regularly. Like, to me as a child, these stores were just a part of me growing up. One store, I don't even know if it had an actual name. Just to me, and I think to my family and to a lot of other people, we just called it the corner store. Like, we literally went to that store so often. For me, it was always to get candy. Like, the only time, it really was just me, my sister, and my aunt. We were just like a trio. We did so much stuff together. You know, we would go to the store, we would get the candy, and I guess my parents or whoever took us would do other things. There was the laundromat, which I hated going to. Like, it was rare that I went there, but every single time we did, I hated it because I would literally do nothing. I would just be with them, maybe carrying some of the bags filled with all these laundry clothes. And it was just a ton of waiting around. And the reason that was because so many people had to do their laundry. And of course, you can only do your laundry if there was an available machine. And because there were so many people, you couldn't walk away from your machine. If you did, people would take your clothes out and put their clothes in. Like, and I'm not kidding. Like, I don't think that was to be rude or mean, but it was just like they have all of these clothes. They need to get back to their place, you know, at a particular time. So it really was just like, you need to just get what you have right now. Because of that, it was just a bunch of waiting around and it stunk. Like, it really did. Gosh, I hated that. I'm trying to remember anything else. I think from my experiences in Seat Pleasant, that may be it. Like my experiences are comparatively very light and easygoing compared to other people who lived in Seat Pleasant. My grandmother, my parents, my sister, my aunt, they all probably have their own, not even probably, they all have their own experiences of how it was in Seat Pleasant, because I feel like that, I was about to say, I feel like the age you are kind of, varies. Oh my gosh, I'm sorry. I just remembered one very important thing. It was weird because my heart kind of skipped a beat thinking like, oh wait, should I say that? I think I will. I didn't learn this until I was older. But in where we lived, in our apartment, there was a second apartment. It was like, there's just these big buildings. It was our apartment, and there was and another one next to us. And there was a guy. I'm sorry. There was a guy who lived there. And, oh, jeez. I'm sorry. Now that I'm, like, talking about this now. Okay, there is very little. There's very, very little that I remember from this and from him. From some things that I was told, I think he would throw... Oh, jeez. I think he would throw candy out his window to the kids who were there. That wasn't me. I wasn't there. But I do remember this one time distinctly. And I remember I got in so much trouble. My parents told me to take out the trash. They said that just go straight to the dumpster, and all of this was visible from our window. Go straight to the dumpster, throw the trash away, come right back. And I had the trash, I went to throw the stuff away, and as I was walking back, I was hearing a cat meow. And I was curious, because, you know, I was like, it sounded really loud. And it sounded like it was coming from somebody's window that was on the other apartment. So it's like, I hear the cat, I'm like leaning towards it to try to see if I can see it, like through the blinds, but I couldn't see it. And after a few minutes go by, my sister comes out and she says, Julian, you need to get into the house, you're in trouble. I was like, what did I do? I was like, I didn't. And then I go back into the house and then my parents are yelling at me. They were so mad at me. They were like, Julian, we told you to go into the house after you take out the trash. But I was like, I know, but I heard this cat meow. They're like, no, I think I may have even gotten a spanking. I don't know. I got yelled at really, really bad. And now that I am older, it was that guy. He was making these little cat meow sounds. This is a mess with me, I guess. Like, it's really weird. Like, that's the thing. I thought that, you know, of course, they didn't see me because, like I said, I'm going out of the house to do the trash and come back. But this is what I was told when I got older. Every single time where I went out of the house, my parents always watched. They never took their eyes off of us. They were watching me through the window. That's how they saw what I was doing. And that's when I guess they told my sister to go out and tell him to come in the house. But yeah. Like, luckily, like I said, nothing happened. Like I said, I barely even remember that guy. Like I said, I didn't even know that about him until, like I said, I was much older. So like I said, luckily, like I said, I'm fine, I'm okay, nothing like happened, but yikes, like, oh my goodness. Let's see, was there anything else? I thought there was another thing, but I don't quite remember. But yeah, you basically get the idea. Like, I lived in an environment that was dangerous, but there were a lot of other areas that was much more dangerous. And I guess it wasn't easy growing up. Like I said, I myself didn't notice that because, you know, I was so young and I'm just thinking about kid stuff. Like I said, like Nick Jr. and like I said, my Hot Wheels and just like going to school and regular stuff. But looking at it through the eyes of an adult, yeah, I guess you can say it was hard. You know, our house was always crowded. We, you know, sometimes had difficulty, you know, with food and just basic low income neighborhood issues, you know. Luckily, however, my parents were saving up money to move. Something did happen though, to where I think my dad got hit by a bus in a car and he broke his leg. He didn't die, but he broke his leg. And the money that he got from that, like, of course, the bus company paid him money. That helped us. Like I said, they were already saving up money beforehand, but that helped us move. Like, that, I believe, was the part where we moved out and we moved into another neighborhood in Upper Marlboro, Maryland, which is a story in itself that I will share with you another time. I've moved several times, actually. Maybe about two or three, but that living in Upper Marlboro is its own little story. Not as crazy, I don't think, as my time in Seat Pleasant, but just say while I was in Upper Marlboro, you know, I was older, other things did happen, I didn't meet other people, and a lot of other crazy stuff happened while I was in school. But like I said, that's a story for another day. But, yeah, I hope you enjoyed this. Like I said, I will make this into a series, just my life. A lot of the stuff may be out of order because maybe if I remember, I just shared with you stuff that happened to me while I was living in Seat Pleasant, but maybe like as time goes on and I remember something else, I may bring that up at a later time. So expect it to kind of be I'll try to keep it chronological as best I can, but you know, you get the point. But yeah, so thank you so much for tuning in. I hope you learned something, you know, about me. Expect to learn, you know, a lot more. But yeah, so thank you so much for tuning in, and I'll talk to you in the next one. See ya.